He wishes hot dogs around town? Like Lisa drop around.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome you tonight to our city council meeting. This is Monday, February the 6th, 2017, at approximately 7:08 p.m. Ms. Derry, if you'd call the roll, please.
Trustee Brown.
Here.
Here.
Callis, Epstein, and Wapanya.
Here.
Tim Curry.
Here.
Lance Curry is absent. We do have four.
Rod is now here.
Rod is here.
Okay, if you would please stand for our prayer and pledge allegiance this evening. I'd like to invite Dr. Burgess to the microphone for our prayer this evening and our pledge led by Chief Dawson.
Would you bow, please? All-wise and all-knowing Heavenly Father, we come this evening with thanksgiving in our heart, and we praise you as the only true and living God. Father, we ask that you be with us in this meeting this evening. We pray, Father, that you would be with our community and be with our leaders, those in authority over us. Father, give them wisdom and understanding that they might make rules and determine regulations for our community that would be helpful for us. But Father, we realize that you are the great lawgiver. And help us that we might live in accordance to your will. And help us, Father, nationwide. We pray for our nation because we're divided. And help us, Father, that we might come together in unity. And may we again be a God-fearing Christian nation. Father, we pray that you would go with us now. May we live for you. May we serve you faithfully. We ask for the forgiveness of our sins. And Father, we ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. May you see it. Thank you, Dr. Burgess. Thank you, Chief Dawson. At this time, I would ask for the council to consider minutes for the January 9th council meeting and also the January 25th special call council meeting.
Make a motion to approve those minutes.
Second.
Have a motion and a second to approve the minutes?
Yes.
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 Thank you. No actual approval of the mayor's bond report, but thank you for the council for the approving the new city vehicle. It works very well. We've taken it as far as the high school so far. Chief and I drove it up there for All right, I'm sorry, we actually didn't go to the ribbon cutting in Fort Smith for a new chamber, Greenwood Chamber number two, so. Very nice to do. We'll go down to the committee reports. South Station County Boys Girls Club. Andy Sunday, how did you get away?
Head right back there. Your team doesn't play for another hour.
Oh, okay.
So, and I wouldn't. Yeah, very well, we all, like I said, thank you for coaching, thank you for coaching those kids. That's really making a difference to them and everything has been going great. I'd like to thank Mr. Rob, he's let us use his lift to fix our lights and everything out. Some money that we're wanting to get out there, and we appreciate it. We had the chief, and we appreciate the chief and a couple of his officers coming out. We had a little drawing that the kids did that colored some police cars and stuff like that. And I appreciate his patience when the kids were asking to be tasered. So that was a big thing. And I'm sorry I missed last month with basketball going on. It's hard to get away. I'll be here next month, but then when I have baseball, so I'll try to do everything I can to be out here. We're towards the end of our basketball season, which has been a great success with the increase in every age group except for one. We just did flag football signups. We got about 80 kids going to play flag football this year, which is great, especially for the fifth and sixth graders and the fourth graders that are not quite into tackle football yet. It gives them something where their parents feel comfortable and you kind of get them ready for at least the seventh grade if they decide to play or just an activity. We just started baseball and softball signups. We're looking for a huge year. We already have 40 coaches signed up. We'll probably end up with about 70 coaches this year. We've got some calls around the town wanting to bring some of their teams over and play in our league. So we're doing that to help them out and also gives our kids more people to play. Besides that, our septic system blew up today, so we'll find out tomorrow. It's been a struggle with that system. It's probably 20, 25 years old. We'll find out tomorrow, get it fixed and everything. So hopefully that won't be too bad. You might hear something from people. We have went up on our gate. We will be starting baseball and everything. We will be going up to $3 a game. We were at $2. We have not gone up in 19, 20 years. Insurance, utilities, everything has gone up. We have done everything in our power to keep it down. But we're going to have to go up. To be able to, and also do more upkeep and some improvements out there and everything. So we're going to go up on that. We've joined in with a little, travel ball's gotten real big, so all these leagues are losing a lot of people. We have been very fortunate not losing a ton as far as our numbers are not coming down, but we still. So what we've done, excuse me, we are going to put some teams together. They're basically like all-star teams, but it's whoever wants to play. And we joined in with Van Buren, Alma, and Church League. So we're all going to have 4 weekends where we're going to do tournaments and send teams to the other facilities. That generates revenue for all of us, plus it gives our kids more games, and their parents don't have to spend $1,000, $1,500 to join a travel team and to go everywhere. So we're going to start that this year, and hopefully it's really good. So, anybody have any questions or anything? Yes, sir.
Septic.
Yes, sir.
Close to city sewer. Is it
cross 71?
It's cross 71. When are we going to cross 71, Steve?
That's a good question. We don't have an immediate plan for that.
If it turns out real costly, I don't know, you got to get it fixed.
Yeah, we have to get it fixed.
We need to cross 71 to make things grow on the other side.
It was a great, and I think that septic will just generate all kinds of interest on that side of the highway. And having the runway there, Doug, was you there when they originally put it in?
Oh, yeah.
And it was state of the art. I mean, and that's what the state said you need out there. Well, 3 years after they put it out there, the company goes out of business because it wasn't the state of the art. And now there's one guy who works on it, gave the parks in Arkansas.
Do you still have the real cool fountains out of the sewer?
Yes, sir.
And you play them?
Yeah, they do. But supposedly, when you read it, when they shoot the water out, you can actually put a cup underneath there and drink it.
Drink it, yeah. I was told that, too.
Yeah, but we haven't tried. And, but yeah, it's, so we do have a water feature out there.
They're going out of business because kids drink in the water, they don't want to drink.
That's right.
What's the nearest sewer line?
In the direction.
Right across?
Just a question. School?
There's one near Walmart. So we just have, you have to push under the four-lane highway. But then you have to take, you know, consideration the height, what the height of the land is versus where the sewer pipe is. So we don't want to put a pump station over it.
What would that cost?
Push it under?
Yes.
You're looking at $500,000 at least.
Just to get it on the other side of 71?
Get it on the other side of 71, because we got a border left. You know, it's not something you just take a backhoe and...
Daniel, remember we run down there and we made the decision not to run down to 71? It was $100,000 then.
It won't be cheaper next year.
No, it won't be cheaper next year.
Well, we just spent $128,000 on that Walmart line, and that wasn't a long stretch line, and that was all above ground, so.
I think we have a problem with fall on that side, too.
Yeah, because you'd have to put a pump station over there if it's lower than the sewer on that side.
I think that line crossing Highway 71 would be the best economic development we could do.
It's on the plan to look at. We're currently looking at the property for water and sewer possibly here at the end of 71 and Tinsburg. In the Burton properties.
But if you still want to candy bars out there to raise money, put this through.
You know, candy bars are almost 25 cents.
Is it?
Not in our concession, that's the next thing we'll change. But you have to raise price on the concession because of kids. Some of that's only one part of it. And our after-school program is just booming. And we've implemented smart girls now. So we have about 25 girls participating in that, and we're really excited for the brand new program starting.
Now that I've found that list, I'm going to start picking this up.
Okay.
Real
yes, sir. Okay. Yeah, well, you told me keep it until you need it.
I got a job coming up.
Okay. $20 for that. No, but yes, sir.
Maybe y'all start using it.
No, we got everything going in there. Anybody else? Well, we appreciate everything y'all do for us, because without y'all, we'd probably be cutting the lights on about 2 hours at a time, and that's it. So we really appreciate it.
Thank y'all. Thanks, Kenny. Appreciate what you do up there. SRCA, you know, Lisa is not here tonight, but you have a report, I believe, in your packet. And if you have any questions regarding that report, we can get that to Ms. Moore. We'll go to the Parks Commission. Richard, did you get the report? Any questions regarding that? And while you're looking at that, I'll ask Mr. Gary Grimes to switch the report.
I really don't have anything. I didn't do a report, but I will. Sonny asked me last week, about a house bill of 1018. It's the same bill that we looked at probably 2 years ago. And they've not enabled us to annex by ordinance. So we face the same thing, although this time it's, as of just in the last week or so, it hasn't been out of committee yet. So more than likely it will either die in committee or it'll be really close to being in possession if they try to move it out.
This would disallow to annex a by ordinance on it?
Actually, it takes away the ability for you to annex on a piece of property that's already surrounded by ordinance, it's been annexed by ordinance, it would not allow you to be able to annex.
Right.
It's property without a...
Who's the sponsor of the bill?
Good question. Cozar.
He's out of Hot Springs.
Yes. And it's a, if there's a quarrel...
He's always been meddling.
They all do it away. But there's a quarrel between the city of Hot Springs and some others down there. Now, this bill is directed just for that. Of course, when the bill passes, then it makes the entire state.
Makes the entire state.
So rather than, I guess, to go over all of these, I'll bore you with just that one. Everything else is moving on. I mean, there's a lot of discussion about tax cut. Of course, there's the governor's tax cut, which causes there to be fine dollars for that, and he's been able to do so far. And then the other thing is medical marijuana, of course, it's kind of quite an issue.
Stubblefield's bill for sanctuary cities, is that gaining life?
I don't think that it will. I'll be surprised that it does, although it has moved along quicker than some of these bills. But I don't know how that's going to affect Greenwood.
Has the municipal legal security in that time?
Yes. I mean, they're saving their pipe to see how far it moves to the committee and where it ends up before they send resources to fight that. But again, I don't know exactly how it would affect them. And we're not in that position, essentially.
Any news on the governor's thoughts on, I know GIF is...
I think his thoughts on it are the GIF dollar.
No new plan?
No, not a new plan. There may be, there are some people that like I and across the state and how are the cities and counties going to come up with some dollars now, but when they look at all the GIF, is there any way to still bring the dollars back? And so there are some people that are looking at other alternatives other than GIF, which that's fine. Whatever alternative they come up with, as long as it works.
There is one.
Exactly.
Maybe we could write another one.
We could. If we have another thought.
Yeah.
Any questions? Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Mr. LeJean, you may use G.
Mayor Council, Mr. Gary, can you hear me? Just a couple things to report on real quick. We're going to take bids for the work at the street department at the next meeting, March, what are we going to do? Right? So they are not looking at the 7th. Monday holiday.
March the 6th, I believe.
Yeah.
So that's the day we'll take it to whatever day the city council.
Okay.
One of the questions that came up last time when you guys met, I was here to answer some of the questions, was about putting brick on the front facade of the building. One of the things we're doing is we're only taking brick up to 4 feet around the building because there's a purlin that runs around the building at 4 feet. And if we take the brick up full height, we'll have to run metal studs up and extend them all the way up. It's just a lot of added extra cost. We're going to look at using brick the same color as the fire station and metal panels the same color as the fire station. So at least as far as the whole complex, we'll have the same colors and cones in all the buildings, and I think that'll be well suited for us then. Plus that, it's more of our main building, so it seemed like a lot of added cost to do that. But if you guys want us to do that, you can. Another question that came up was about the landscaping. The only area that we currently have any landscaping shown is along the back fence. That building currently has paving all the way around it, and one of the things that we're trying to address is the drainage problem. So we're actually coming out and lowering all the grades around the perimeter of the building. You can put concrete in so that we can drain it properly and try to keep water from running back up in the building. If we cut out areas and leave it open for landscaping, I don't think we're going to solve the problem that you already have. But again, it's your your building, so if you want us to take those areas out, we can, but I would recommend against it. We looked at another area along the street, along Bell Road, talked to the mayor about it a little bit. It's something that we wouldn't have to do as part of this project for the street department, but if you guys did want to look at some landscape out there, we could do that, put in an island that kind of separates Bell Road from the street. You know, basically now you got this wide open paving, but you guys have so much traffic coming in with the street department and with the emergency vehicles coming at certain times. I hate to add an island in there, something else where you guys have to navigate around in emergency situations, but guess it really depends on how important the landscaping is. We are going to add a little bit, but weren't planning on putting landscaping all the way around the building.
You keep saying us, but what did the planning department say about the landscaping?
They've not reviewed the plans yet.
Have you already put them out?
No.
Okay.
No. It'll be another week because there's 3 weeks of bid time.
When does the planning department give you?
We turn them in when we set them, turn them out.
Current landscaping plan meets the city's.
There's no way to meet the current plan with your current setting right now. I mean, we would have to tear out all the paving to put in landscaping, so.
Planning board?
We can do that, but it just seems counterproductive for the project and what you have currently set up there now.
Planning department okay with?
They've not reviewed plans yet.
Rod, they'd have to bring it from the planning commission and they'd have to grant them a variance.
So is that happening?
Pardon?
Is that going to happen?
Could be. I'm just a man at the front. It's up to the planning commissioners. I don't make that decision.
I mean, the process is happening.
Yes, yes.
That process is going to happen.
That process will happen.
And they'll have the opportunity to grant a variance.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah, we won't start that until we turn it over to review.
We're still going to treat ourselves any different than we treat anybody else.
Absolutely not.
But there's, you're on, I guess it's the south wall that's adjacent to the parking lot. There's, we can't keep any of that landscaping there because we're going to fill that in concrete.
There's not any landscaping there now. There's grass that's kind of all beat up and got chunks of concrete and everything else in it. So that area is one of the problems. The sidewalk that turns in there now is currently higher than the floor elevation. And when the water comes over the top of that curb now, it's filling up and running into those rooms. So we're going to lower all of the grades right there and bring the concrete all the way around. So it'll be a concrete sidewalk going all the way around the building out to the end of the building. And then from the end of the fence that starts at the end of the building, we're going to leave landscaping down in that area. So it's about 35 feet long there. And then we can add the island if that's something you want to look at, or we're going to turn the plans in as is, and then obviously we'll go with that. But, have the connecting variance, that's what we'll request.
Could you not come off of the building, Michael, on this corner, on this far corner, and go straight out front of the building itself with a little island there without getting out into? Because I know if you try to put one out in the middle, like you said a while ago, not only is their traffic, but these big trucks, 18-wheelers, are coming there. And I know that in itself is in the way, but not as much as it is. That something to consider?
Yeah, we could. I mean, that's something that we could.
It'd be like taking space.
Yeah, it's going to take parking space, right. Obviously been a concern on everything that we've done over here.
Right.
Paving wise, every time we take up one space, it's an issue. So we would at least leave one, maybe two spaces to rework that area. But we'll definitely, it's not something we're going to avoid. We've got a landscape plan. We're going to turn them in just like for review, and then we'll go through the process as needed. And we're going at it with this approach currently. And if they ask you something different, we'll go down that road and we'll get to it. The other thing that we asked about was, I met with Simon the month before, and we looked at adding a covered area that would just be a metal building frame with a roof and sidewalls, be approximately 50 by 75, and it would go out where they hold their sand now, generally in that area. We're going to make a recommendation that we not bid that as part of this first work. Two reasons. One is because there's a lot of work happening in this first section, and I want to see what that costs first before we start adding a whole lot of other work to the project. Second is, if we do that building out there, I need to get a survey. There's a lot of utilities out there, and I just can't wing it and put it on the drawings and hope that we don't get something. I mean, there's too many things in the way. Plus, we've got to look at a lot of things with the grades and everything, and I'm not willing to take that on myself without survey information. There's too many factors involved, and you're talking about pretty slope across there, and we want to make sure we have it right, and we have drainage and everything to address. So I would like to bid that separately. So we'll get our bids next month for everything we've talked about so far, and then if we're still at or under budget, we can look at the second piece, bid it separately, and it may be a small enough portion-wise, cost-wise, that we could change order again to the contract for the contractor that wins the first bid. So it'd be an easy way to handle that as well. It'd be an option that we could do that. So, and I think I wouldn't proceed with a survey until that time. We get the bids in March, because I'm going to spend money on the survey if we're not going to build it. Any more questions about the tree farm?
What's your educated guess on what this bid will come in?
I don't really have a good idea. There's lots of pieces to it. New roof, new sidewalls, reworking, paving, moving some grades down. It's like any other project. Every time we come in, everybody asks for a little bit more, so we try to accommodate the best we can, but I've been keeping the mayor apprised every time that we've added something to the project and try to keep you guys advised. I brought a copy of the plans, everything we've got so far, which includes currently the cover building is shown on the drawings, and you're totally welcome to look at that afterwards. But once we turn out the bid, I'll have a better idea of where we're coming in, bid number one, for that day.
Is there anything that's been added that we can bid as an additional cost that could be taken back out? What type of things have been added since it originally started?
Well, we've added with more garage doors, we made them bigger. And what we had originally, we're just going to replace what's there. Now we made a couple of them wider, relocated them, added some new exterior doors because we replaced more of the skin. We're also going to go ahead and replace the skin around that little cover portion in the back because it's the only one stretch of it, it's the only piece that wouldn't match. Replace the roof. Well, we had the roof on the entire thing. And as we got into the grades, we realized a little bit more issues with the concrete out there. So we're just going to bring more curving around down to this dents down here, which is going to be a little bit more. I mean, they're all small things, but they all add up. We haven't added any major scope to the project. I mean, there's no electrical, no plumbing, other than just some miscellaneous things that got to move. But, you're stripping it down to the...
Well, that all sounds like things that we need.
Yeah, and I think they're all things that are needed. I just wanted to alert you that those things were happening along the way. So. Guys know, because we always kind of start off with here's what we think it's going to cost, and it comes in higher, so I want everybody to be prepared.
And I'm looking at our budget, and I don't see the size of the budget. You know where it is.
I was looking for it, seeing how much was in there for it.
Simon, do you remember the amount that was budgeted?
They had budgeted anything for the building remodel, and we discussed that in the budget sessions. The reason is because it's an arbitrary number. I don't know what the dollar amount is on that, so I'll plan on doing a resolution at the time.
Absolutely. So, yeah, okay. No amount in there. Okay.
No amount in there.
It's not a blank check, but I'm not one to put... Like I said, there's too many pieces, and I don't have control over the project on bid day. The only thing I have control over is what's in the scope, and I feel like everything that we put in the scope is stuff that you guys have asked for, and I've alerted you guys, anyone that doesn't know about the things that we've added or changed to the project. And that's why I'm looking at things like not going ahead and bidding these other the buildings that have been asked to be added, because if you're way over budget, I don't want to have done all this work and have to just turn around and take it out, because I think with what we got, we're going to have a nice project, and it's going to be significant, but I mean, it's going to be some dollars associated with that. And I want you guys to feel like you're getting what you're paying for. And I want to start off by just cutting off a part of the project, because I'm telling you now, I think we're there. I think we're there with what your expectations are.
How old is the existing building?
Old. Yes, it was built in late 90s.
The white gun?
Oh, no, that's right, no, it was a fact, I just hope it didn't answer.
Burgess, it was a factory before.
Burgess, are you aware of how old the street department building might be?
I'm thinking it was built in the 80s. Around when that.
Right.
Time.
We're pushing a 30-year-old building.
Yeah. And the bottom, I mean, the bottom of the building are good, it's just that, you know, got a lot of roof leaks and the skin is leaking and you got some drainage issues around the corner, we're trying to address all those things with what we're doing. And there's some access issues with driving trucks and they're backhoes through the building, so that's why we're moving the doors, you know, so those are all things that, you know, they're needed in the long run.
We were looking at what you got so far, what do you think the chances are, is this 400,000?
I think we're less than that.
300,000?
I'm not sure yet. I'm gonna say, well, between those two numbers. I just don't have enough, this is, like, when you're building pizzas of skin, which is what we're doing, that's not stuff we can easily square foot for us. I mean, we'll use the square foot, the total building cost, so when I'm breaking it up into small pieces, because the problem you have is you only have a problem, I'm building it new, but I'm also taking it all off, so I've got to pay, you know, price, a premium on those items to take it off and put it back on. So if you're square footing, that's a little bit difficult.
Just don't think it, 400 is probably the case.
Yeah, and that's why I was getting afraid of adding the other building.
Gotcha.
Because I thought we might be creeping on $500,000 project and then well beyond what we talked about initially.
We're probably going to have problems if it comes down to more, maybe about $415,000.
I mean, that's the number that we've been trying to stay below that 400. That's kind of what our budget, our overall budget was from the beginning.
Sounds good. Thanks.
A couple other things real quick. The Lake Crew probably already has this in his report, but they're working on a parking lot. I'm out there, and we have volunteers coming in on February 11th to work more another mile on the trail. We are presenting the Bell Park splash pad analysis with Larkin Aquatics on February 20th at the Parks Commission meeting. And then we got the pre-approval for the pre-design estimate and proposal for the municipal park. I think we'd like to, so we're going to start, we'll start working on that in the next couple weeks. Any other questions?
Michael, I think at Parks meetings,
21st. I've got all my dates off by day, sorry.
Would you like to know what this paper is?
Okay.
Till we run here, I'll keep that.
All right, thank you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ben.
Thank you, Mike. Appreciate it. Water Wastewater Commission, Mr. Radry.
Mayor, Council, Mr. Terry, Mr. Schmidt, we should have a report available to you. Just wanted to point out a couple things. Budgets were finalized, obviously. We did set, and I think we talked about this the previous meeting, minimum balance of $500,000 for water to never go below, and a sewer balance of $250,000 to maintain. And then we also went ahead and set a city sales and use tax of $100,000 so that we don't spend those money. They're allocated not to right below. We talked about Mr. Witt and the discount. You guys asked me to go back to the commission and make a recommendation on the discount. The commission decided that $500 was adequate. I'm going to explain to you how we arrived at that number in a little bit. I'm going to finish up and then we'll do that in just a couple minutes. Today we spent $1,125,000 and some change for the $2,250,000, so we're about halfway through our budget. We still don't see any issues in meeting our budget expectations, so we're very comfortable with where the numbers are. And then kudos to Tim. He worked diligently with the gentleman that did our ISO. He actually
worked with him on recommending some different fire hydrants than were on the list, and Tim went out and flowed some of those to try to make sure that we were going to get the maximum on those, and I think that was favorable in the recent ISO, and I guess Stuart covered that.
I won't come up and talk unless they ask me.
So that was favorable, I guess, that was where the guys already went down. So on the Mr. Webb recommendation, Mr. Webb was provided notification just like all the other landowners were, with adequate time to do whatever he needed to do. I misspoke in the last meeting that we had. I was under the impression that his property and Mr. Lynn's property were swapped. He actually didn't provide us any sort of opportunity on his property. Mr. Lynn is the one who provided for 90 days where we stored all the material, so it wasn't Mr. Webb.
He
didn't disagree with it. So that was my bad. The only thing that we did do was use his driveway to access the property, but we did not store any material. So we consulted with our engineering, Jeremy Shores, and they came back and told us typically what to try to do is get a price per square foot on a piece of property. We used the assessed value of the property at the time of construction. So that's always questionable, because at the time of construction, for that entire lot, the assessed, the 5 acres, the 4.75 acres that were bought in total, that was owned by the people before Mr. Glenn and Mr. Witt bought those properties, was only $36,000 is what was assessed on the county books. So by the time you do the calculations, it averages out to 18 cents a square foot. Then we took the 260 foot of frontage that Mr. Webb had, times 15 foot for the easement, calculated at 3,900 feet, multiplied the 18 cents times the 3,000. That came up to $702 roughly. And then the engineering recommended that they only allow 50% of that for an easement. So that's $350. Then they allow 10% for the driveway, and that was $35. So if you take his total, if you take the total of what they would allow for an easement for driveway access, it's less than $400. So the commission thought that they would make a recommendation to the council. Council can do whatever you choose to do. It's your ordinance, but our recommendation was to allow him a $500 discount off of his 50% discount that he's already getting from the original fees. So, you know, he's looking at about $22,000 to $23,000 in his connection fees, and then a $500 discount toward that. So I will leave that in your hands. Do you have any questions about that?
We need to take a vote to offer him the discount.
You do need to take a vote to offer him the discount, and he did ask me to find out how long that offer would be extended. He did meet the 90-day time frame by bringing it to our attention. So, but he wants to know how long that offer is going to be extended. I don't think he's looking to pay it now. So my recommendation would be that we just offer it, you know, for 30 days, and then if he's not ready to purchase those taps within 30 days, they'll go back to the original price.
But he didn't offer, I mean, none of his landowners said it was the access to the driveway.
So we only use the driveway only. All the storage was done on Mr. Lane's property.
Now, we do continue to use that driveway. Is that something we might need to look at?
We're not using it. It's
well,
Mr. Lynn's contractor's name. Okay. Using it. That's okay. That's out of the city. Okay.
That's true. It was concrete trucks. What I saw was using, so it was the developers.
It would be the developers. The only time we used that driveway was to get access to the Walmart property.
Right. Okay.
Do you know if the Planning Commission has approved what this guy's wanting to build out there? Is it even the Planning Commission?
10 years of packet.
What is it?
We haven't approved it yet.
I was talking about the storage units that Mr. Wiz was wanting to. Is that what you're?
Yes.
Well, I know if the Planning Commission has approved this.
And I've kept him in the loop on everything.
They're not for a plan.
They don't have a plan for that either.
For what?
For getting done right
I've kept him in the loop, Mr. Witt, on every decision and every opportunity for a decision that's going to be made, and copied the mayor on that as well. So he's well informed of what the process is and where we're going with it and what the next steps are.
Well, I think this counts between the high, but I'm good with it.
I'll make a motion we follow the recommendations of our commission at this county, $500 for a period of 30 days.
Second. Got a motion to second.
Did that 30 days start today?
Nope. Yes.
Okay, second round.
Yes.
Ms. Brown?
Yes.
Dr. Johnson?
Yes.
Yes.
Mr. McDaniel?
Yes.
Tim Terry?
No.
Lance Terry?
Yes.
Pass the ballot to me.
You have a question for me?
Yes, Steve, I'm talking about sewer across the 71. You know, as far as growth out that way, is there any need for a treatment plant over on the west side of town, or just our current facilities, do they handle?
I think it'd be difficult for me to speak about that without consulting engineering. We'd have to really kind of see what's going to go on out there. But I heard something that was a little bit confusion. I heard something that somebody said about a municipal discussion, municipal park discussion. I don't know where that's going.
The idea was that it would be on the east side.
And is that going to contain the ballpark facilities in that as well?
That is, yeah.
So why would we go spend money pushing sewer under the street?
We would obtain, with that project, we would obtain that property for development.
Okay.
So I'm assuming something would build out there if the ballpark's where they're gone.
So
sewer would be
we would have to look at the capacity to make sure, what's going to go out there, what potentially could go out there. There's always a possibility of developing a substation for sewer treatment that's costly. The ideal situation would be to be able to push it to the sewer plant that we already have, but we're not going to stop growth for the city because we can't, accept the sewer. We'll tackle that challenge. Otherwise, we just need to pack up and go home.
Well, I guess on the other line of that, on the other thought of that, as far as within the city limits, do we have a list of, number of residences within inside the city limits that are on a septic tank system? That could be on sewer.
We have a list of customers that pay sewer bills, and we have a list of people who are paying water bills, and the list of people paying water bills is much greater than people paying wastewater bills. So we could probably get some rough numbers. Shadow Lake residences is 129 people on water, approximately 129, approximately 99 are people on wastewater. So there's some differences depending on which part of town, but we could get you some numbers up there.
We'll get those numbers and bring them back to the next meeting so that you have a rough idea. And then we're moving toward that path from an engineering standpoint to be able to look. We're going to look at this Burton property first and kind of see what we've got going on there. We can look at that across the street. I do think that Greg has already taken a laser out there to try to figure out what the topography of it was. And so I can get with him when he's back and then try to find out what the results on that were. That'll tell us what the fall is going to be, whether or not. I think it's actually lower on that side of the street than it is on the Walmart side, which is going to require a pump station.
If I may, I think something on what you just said is, I'd like to just say that, and I'm all about getting some sewer over on that side of the highway too. I think it's going to be important for Greenwood's future growth, but I think it's also real important that we consider those homes in the city limits that have lived without sewer for years. I know you're doing that, but the last thing I think we want to do is say we're going to put sewer out to empty property that has nothing on it before we consider taking care of people that live in city limits. Is that fair to say? We'll check into that. There's a lot of people. I don't have what the number is either, but there's a lot.
Well, we'll figure out what the number is and start maybe putting something on the map so you can see where we are. Some areas just don't make sense.
My house is a great example.
Sure.
It's lower than the street.
And this is not about me by any means, but I live a mile literally up this way toward the school.
Is that sewer on, that they're working on now?
No. That's gas company, man. Different gas.
Mayor, don't hold me to this number, but my memory is it's 3,400 wastewater customers, and we have 3,872 water meters, something like that. Maybe 400 to 600, what would you say? That's wrong justice, but I can get you a better number.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Also, you're talking about not wanting to run sewer under the highway up to there. I mean, is that something you'd like for a river to go up the land in the ballpark to the left and put the bill on?
Right. I mean, typically, that's what we prefer to do, is have the developer put in the infrastructure. But if we're trying to make deals with, you know, swapping property and things like that, then you have to take all that into consideration.
Well, I know it's not sewer line, but the water line that you just put in 12 inches up, and you look what that's done already, so.
And sewer,
that's right.
I was going to say, I appreciate the Water and Wastewater Commission's role in what y'all played in helping us get a lower ISO rating. Thank you for y'all's part. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thanks, Steve. The agenda for the citizen forum, we had no one sign up this evening, but as always, I would remind you, if you didn't know or forgot to sign up, we would certainly entertain the notion if you had anything to speak on tonight. Looks like we don't. And I was waiting with the drum roll, please, for the second month in 1 year, for the second month in a row, we have no agenda additions. Thank you very much. That's not a big deal to some people, but it is. Oh, Mike, did you have an agenda? I didn't ask.
No.
Oh. Wow. You let me go through that whole speech?
Well, I don't know if I said we need to add to the agenda. I just wanted to make you aware. Charlotte and I have been dealing with the Mexican restaurant out here, on their A&P tax. I sent them a threatening letter, and they came in with the day, and made an initial payment to Charlotte, and promised for them to be back with the rest. We haven't heard hide or hair of them from then. My letter said that that would be the one and only letter that they would get from me, and that it makes Charlotte happy, then I was going to be back with the lock and put on their door. Unfortunately, I can't do that without you guys' approval. I mean, some direction from you, whether you want me to try and send them a letter, or whether or not you want me to...
Can you grab the others?
To get a court order to shut it down.
We've been dealing with this a long time, and they've been commissioned, so they've had plenty of time. It's 6 months.
I think that they paid me similar ones.
And I said, if you come back by December's AMP meeting, pay the rest of it. Okay.
How much money were we talking about?
I mean, it's what they gave us was $300 or $400 per month.
We don't know because they hadn't turned.
But the two things they made.
We're requiring it in our mobile vending, you know, ordinance, you know, here. So I'm thinking, you know, if we're from our mobile vendors and yours, well, that would be determined required from our established.
Are they, my honest question is there someone that we're talking to that's comprehending literally what we're talking about?
They appear to me that they do. But like I said, within the most recent receipt of my letter, they would go out here and take this person.
Yes.
So I don't
know how they're doing. He came in person. And if there was one barrier,
I don't know if they're probably got there to eat, they have no problem.
I make a motion the attorney will proceed as he told her.
Court order?
Yep.
I second it.
I have a question about that. So, again, clarification for you, if you get the lock off,
they would have to pay the full.
And then once they pay, so if we put the lock on tomorrow, but if they come pay, they want to do, they're good to go.
Yeah.
Once they pay, there's no other procedure, they just pay the money and put it up.
So, but are we going to do this over and over again, and what, it's going to, you know, this is good?
Maybe if I get in the newspaper, they'll hear them to the public.
This is not, is this, we've had other places in town that have gotten behind.
Yeah, but not, no response.
Charlotte.
The ones that have got behind and literally went out of business and just disappeared.
The only way we know how to correctly determine how, what behind they are is by going to Arkansas Department of Finance and seeing if they've been paying their state and county taxes.
I bet they have, they are mutual.
They would, because the state doesn't mess around.
Yeah.
So we can take that and determine what they're behind. Is that how we do it?
I have not been through the state, and it's almost honor system what they're reporting on the receipts.
When did we get those figures from? It's been 2 or 3 years we heard from somebody.
Well, that was before.
I can get that information. I think if I'm the owner and there's a lock on my door, my first question is going to be, how much do I owe? Should we have a dollar amount in mind before we put the lock on the door? Does that make sense? I'm all for holding people to the fire and making sure they're paying. Do we have an idea?
Their receipts report.
Do what?
We have to depend on their receipts that they report. And he showed me on a phone, you know, how much he had written down in the picture he took of some record that he had, just a handwritten receipt to the road.
So whatever he brings to us, we will trust the honor system and say, thank you for paying.
What I'm going to do is contact the Department of Finance tomorrow and maybe we gave you more chance. If you would have heard what he said, it was going to be easier.
We probably should be doing that anyway, shouldn't we? I mean, we shouldn't. I'm not saying people are not trustworthy, but that's not a good process.
Yeah, I agree. I think we have to improve that process, and there's room for consistency across what we do.
Right.
The Department of Finance, we can depend on their audit.
Absolutely.
Because they audit me. And, you know, they're pretty consistent. They go back and look in your books, your record keeping. On AP Commission, we're just going kind of on an honor basis, and we know we never have checked. But if we can keep in contact with the Department of Finance every so often, we can go back and back calculate that in.
Will they let just anyone see receipts of another business?
The clerk treasurer should be able to see it.
Well, it's public record.
How is it done in larger communities?
Other communities.
Reinvent the wheel.
Like AP,
City Attorney back when we initially implemented the AOP and they kind of did a longer system. I'm sure Portsmouth doesn't do that, but I'll have to check.
I'd be curious what
their city attorney will see what they do. Yeah.
I agree with Rob, there should be something more definite than just an honor system.
I went the other day and told them they had 3 days, and it got on the fire alarm system. It hadn't been working for ever since they've been in business because of a phantom telephone line that they don't have. Well, they finally got it. So, but, you know, I told you what was different the other day when I went in.
Right.
Looked more like an officer with the firearms.
Would it be appropriate to add that to the log on?
Needless to say, they made a change quickly.
Well, he's got that. Okay. They've got it done. But that took a long time. They show a history of not complying with
the theirs. Do they understand you all right?
They did that time.
Yeah. Yeah. He was backing.
So is there a motion to second?
Yeah. We did a motion to second.
For the attorney to proceed as necessary on that right now. Right? Right, Mr. Moore?
Yes.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Dr. Johnson?
Yes.
Powell?
Yes.
McDaniel?
Yes.
Terry?
Yes.
Nester?
Yes.
And let it be known that we enjoy Mexican food, and we want businesses to come, but we expect them all to be equally responsible for their taxes. And we did all that without adding it to the agenda, so we still set a record. Okay, no one on, we have no old business.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, sir.
I hate to do this. We kind of touched on it for a minute. I was just going to ask Sonny about the planning department report.
Yes, sir.
On the second page, just talking about the construction we got going on out of Tinspur.
Yes.
I'm assuming the Dollar Tree project. Well, let's talk about a setback variance and stuff. I know council used to get those variances. It would be like final approval on a variance. I didn't know if it was this kind of situation or if we didn't get those anymore or something changed policy-wise.
They haven't been getting them unless it's a severe variance. This was a 2.5-foot variance on the side. And they had to, instead of 7.5-foot, they asked for 5-foot because of a utility easement, and the planning commission granted that. And like I said, if it had been something as far as, building being up closer to the highway or something like that, yes, it would have come to you.
Y'all got you have a number in your head on what becomes severe variance request,
Not really.
The next guy might want to move it 30 feet. Well, that's not, I don't know.
Yeah, not really. I mean, it's one of those things that they go ahead and make the decision so they can start construction if it's something real serious, and they would have had to wait another week before we came to you guys.
Well, I just remember approving plats and stuff up here at one point. I just didn't know if we do that anymore. Are they just for housing?
Yeah.
Subdivisions.
Subdivisions, yes.
I'd like to ask this one, the tractor supply company came in. We never ever once saw anything about that. Just dirt started moving. It's just nice whenever we might, I don't know if these guys care, but my phone blows up nightly. What's going on? I don't have any idea. Don't you approve stuff? No, I don't anymore.
Well, again, if somebody comes in, it's kind of like a house being built. If they come in and it meets all of our building requirements, and it doesn't have to go in front of the planning commission except for landscaping and things like this, then, it pretty much approves because they have met our requirements. Now, if something is off kilter or they can't meet landscaping for whatever reason, then if they granted a variance for that, then I would come and try to keep you in mind what's going on out there, so that when you do have phone calls, you can say Dollar Tree, AT&T, Anytime Fitness.
Yeah.
But that's up to the council what they would want to hear from the planning commission.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks, Sonny. Move into new business, Mr. Handy.
I think I'm sure I'm going to pass this out. Jeff, I had to make some corrections. Actually, last year, changing my attention and my attention again this year on the resolution as far as our pay scale is concerned. In regards to what authority the council has versus authorities over the commissions, the park commission and the water and sewer commission. And what I did was suggest just modifying some language there to reflect that those are still the ranges, acknowledging that the two commissions are self-governing, but strongly recommending that they stay within those guidelines. I know I spoke to at least one of the commissioners, and I know we understand what that means. I just wanted to put it in writing just to make sure I've just modified the language, clarify that. the citizens understand that if they don't satisfy the council can always dissolve the commissions and take back over the management of it, so. But the law does say that they are self-sufficient, that you got to control the purse strings, that still.
I'll make a motion we adopt the resolution.
Second.
A motion and a second to adopt.
Ms. Brown?
Yes.
Dr. Johnson?
Yes.
Ms. Powell?
Yes.
Ms. McNeil?
Yes.
Ms. Terry?
Yes.
And just for clarification purposes too, if the commission decides that it really, really feels strongly that they need to change this, all they have to do is come back to the council and explain their position, ask you guys to modify that, and I think that's the way it should work, so. That's all I have.
Okay, thank you. Number two, planning department, Mr. Bell.
Mayor, Council, Ms. Terry, we had in the last couple of weeks an issue with a homemade food truck park out on Kent Spur across from McDonald's, if you might have seen. This ordinance that I'm presenting to you tonight was put in front of you 6 months ago when they were down on the square, and they kind of went away, and so did the ordinance. But I wanted to bring this back up to you because, again, we are having issues coming up with regulations for a food truck that that we really have no regulations for. The gentleman that owns the food truck first was going to park it next to the house across from McDonald's and cook in the house and bring them out to the food truck, and they were going to sleep in the house while they did this. And so I explained to them they couldn't sleep in that house because it's commercial property, even though it used to be a resident. It had been changed to commercial, and it cannot be changed back to residential. So that stopped that. They wanted to hook up to city sewer and run a pipe underneath the house to that. And along with the state health department, and Don worked with them quite a few times, so we got that taken care of. And then the next thing they wanted to do, they moved one of the large LP tanks out there next to the house, and they wanted to hook that up to it. And we told them that once they did that, it becomes a permanent structure, then it would have to fall under commercial guidelines. And so that's been kind of taken care of. I've tried to explain to them that a food truck is a self-contained truck, that you can start the motor up and you can be 10 miles away in a short period of time. And they wanted to put a wastewater tank out there and have the Johnny Can people come by and it get out. And you know, I basically have turned them back on everything like that. But I really don't have the ordinances to back me that will explain to somebody that wants to come in with a food truck what we require, and that's what this one does. It explains that they're readily movable, self-contained, and equipped with such things as permanently mounted freshwater tanks, waste holding tanks, set forth by the Arkansas Department of Health. It cannot be attached to the water or wastewater system of City of Greenwood. That's one paragraph in there. It also states that they can only park on private property with the permission of the property owner. They can only be in C1, C2, C3, and I1, and are during a festival at the mayor's approval on his designated representative. It tells what hours they can that they can be open. This covers this kind of mirrors Fort Smith
mobile food ordinance. Kind of simplified because we don't have the issues that they have up there. But I have put this in front of you. I have emergency clause on it. I would like to have it passed as soon as possible so that I can continue on with this, the one that we're dealing with down there, and any that comes into the future. Basically, what I have told them, if they want to become a food truck, make it self-contained, put it out in the middle of that parking lot so that you've got access all the way around it. Don't butt it up against the house, and you'll have a food truck. But right now, you've got a shed connected to a house that is using, that wants to use our city services, and that's not going to be allowed.
Did you say they own that house or?
They have leased on it. And we talked to the property owner the other day and explained the situation to him because they have like a 6 month lease on it and says, you know, they could use it for storage, but they can't leave it. And if they decided, right now it doesn't have a kitchen in it, they were talking about building a kitchen. Once they build a kitchen, then they really come under some regulations. In a heartbeat. But so that's kind of off the table. They're not sleeping in it, they're not going to be cooking in it. But I need to be able to walk up there and go out in the parking lot and put an X on there and say, here's where we want it. And we don't want to see any lines running anywhere. We might let you run a water hose to it or an extension cord, but that's it. But you're also going to have a generator on there in case that you move somewhere else, because then you are self-contained. If you don't have a generator, if you don't have a way to produce electricity, some way to hold your water, fresh water, and wastewater, then you're not self-contained. You can call it anything you want to, but it's not, and it doesn't fall. It won't be approved by this ordinance.
So what does it say self-contained?
Section A, huh?
Section A, third line down. It says readily movable and approved by the.
Okay, I see it. So okay. They are self-contained equipment.
Yeah. And readily movable. That's another key portion of it. Is they, like I said, they've got to be able to walk up there and turn the key on and drive away from that location. And it's like I told them, I said, I don't understand you not wanting that.
You know, where you have self-contained here, I don't see where they would have to provide their own power.
Well, so there's something here that can't get the city services. So that
self-contained means that you've got to have the ability to have your own power. Now, it's like when the one was down by Century 21, there by, on the corner of Front Center and Denver, they had an electric cord running from Chuck Fawcett, no problem there. They had a thing that you could drive over, but they have the ability, that one had the ability that he could have moved out in the middle of the cow pasture and served hamburgers just like he could there. That's a self-contained mobile vendor.
So. You need to define what a self-contained. I mean, you got this list of definitions.
Well, self-contained equipped with such things, such as permanently mounted freshwater tanks, wastewater holding tanks, set forth by the.
It sounds like what you're meaning by self-contained is that they're able to provide their own power. So that's not specifically outlined. I mean, you could say my definition of self-contained is that it's a closed building and contained within itself.
Well, it says that's set forth by the Arkansas Department of Health. Section 1A.
But you know, well, I do all the ones that are running around again, this area now, they are self-contained. And so the industry itself defines what self-contained is. And that's what I'm, what this is trying to say, it's industry standards of self-contained.
Well, I understand, I'm for it. I just want to make sure we're clear. If we're trying to rush this through and pass this tonight, then we have to get down the weeds in this deal to make sure we're clear on
it. If you want to amend that to put in including power generation or whatever, I have no problem with it. The closer that we can get to.
Well, I mean, what you can do, I mean, let me think about it for a second.
I thought somewhere it did say, yeah, you couldn't hook up to, any city services or around that, I guess, well, you say, or electrical, you know, other than, you know, thing like saying, a slug is.
Right there, just define, say, including electrical generation system. And then, you know, it's there. I have another question, Sam.
Sure.
So, who's writing that stuff down?
Real.
I think Charlie is, I hope you.
Charlie's good.
Where it says waterways in the state of Arkansas, that says that are self-contained, I think we need to change that to, we've got into this deal, to the shall be self-contained.
Where is that planned?
On the, in section A.
One A.
It just says, well, it's under section one, sorry about that, section one A, and then on that line it says, roadways and other waterways in the state of Arkansas that shall be, I think that's what you agree, shall be self-contained.
But when you, I guess along that, in that same section there, when you talk about, in section A, where you're defining what a mobile food vendor is, you know, when you're saying it's a concession stand, concession trailers, push carts, are push carts saying that they can be operated on sidewalks or trails, or do we just say only travel highways, roadways, or waterways? I don't know if that's.
Push cart is not a mobile food cart.
You got it listed. You don't. I mean, that's one of the issues I have with this ordinance. At the very top, you say the ordinance regulating the mobile food vendors / mobile vendors. Well, I need better. What is a mobile vendor? I want to understand that better. It says mobile vendor means any movable concession not used to dispense food. Well, give me an example of what that would be.
Somebody selling Big Rubs and Elvis.
Well, but we have an ordinance that we already passed that addresses, correct me if I'm wrong, didn't we go through an ordinance thing that passed something for vendors? It was specific, this was a different ordinance that came through, right? That's when we came up against the whole, you can't go door, you still can go door to door and sell.
The solicitors.
Yeah, I mean, there's language in that ordinance, I believe.
But I don't know if we have anything that stops the Elvis drugs and the shoes and stuff like that. I'm not sure.
I thought that's what we were addressing about.
We've got that in section 2C, addressing the solicitor permit.
Where at? In this ordinance?
Yeah, I put it in there, that, and about the privilege license and about the AMB tax.
And again, my memory fades, we do all these different ordinances, and over time, I forget which ones we talked about, which one we added.
She calls that ordinance out in that 2C.
Yes. I say if you're going to move around, that's what I'm talking about.
Okay, yeah, I see.
That's the ordinance you're referring to.
Yeah, there's language in that ordinance that deals with mobile vendors. I don't understand why we have to have two ordinances. I mean, to me, I would just strike mobile vendors from this entirely. That the purpose of this is to deal with food trucks. Right? We already have this thing about solicitors. I'd have to pull that ordinance out and look at it, but I think there's language in there that regulates what the mobile vendor is and where it can be and what it can do and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, but this is mobile food vendor.
Well, but it also says mobile vendor.
Yes.
It's got both. Yeah. So I don't understand what we're trying to fit both of them in there. I would say just strike mobile vendors and just stick with the food vendor, which is really what we're trying to do. It just makes it confusing to me, and I'm a little concerned with creating two ordinances dealing with.
Well, we want to make sure we're not in conflict with the other.
That's my point. If we could just strike mobile vendors from the whole thing, I don't think that hurts this ordinance any. Okay. The goal is to regulate the food trucks. And
then you'd read mobile food vendors, concession trailers, push carts.
Okay, and then my question right there would be, if we define mobile food vendors, do we need to separately define concession trailers and push carts? Because we're saying mobile food vendors have to be self-contained in the sense that they have to have their own generator. Well, a push cart's not going to have its own generator. How do you say a push cart's self-contained? So you have to have a separate definition for what is a push cart, what is a concession trailer. They're different things than a mobile food vendor if you're saying a mobile food vendor. Do you understand? You understand the conflict there?
Yeah.
And you can't, I mean, a mobile food vendor is not going to have fresh water tanks and waste holding tanks, right? A push cart's not going to have that. And yet, in the ordinance we say under A, mobile food vendor means food truck or concession stand or concession trailers or push carts. So we're saying that a mobile food vendor is a concession trailer or a push cart. And then we're saying later on in that sentence that they have to have holding tanks and fresh water, and you're not going to make a push guy with this little push cart have all that stuff. So
it says on section 1B of the mobile vendor means any movable concession.
Well, I already said just strike that, because okay. we're not dealing with mobile vendors. We're just dealing with mobile food vendors, because I think we have another ordinance somewhere that deals with mobile vendors.
And
that's
on
9.2,
looking at it, does say outdoor vendors is what transient merchants and outdoor vendors.
That's the road, that's the Elvis road people. So if
we should all get off Elvis.
Yeah, I love Elvis. So if what I would say in 1A is a mobile food vendor means mobile food truck. And just strike that whole concession stand, concession trailer used to dispense food. And
concession trailer could be pulled, like bubble pool trailer, they could be self-contained.
We're gonna make that have wastewater holding tanks and fresh water tanks.
Do, yeah.
Then
Up
at the top, you just need to say operation mobile food vendors. You don't need to say concession trailer, because we're saying a concession trailer is a mobile food vendor. That's redundant. And then you say push carts. If we're gonna say push carts, we kind of need to define what a push cart is, because it's not a mobile food vendor.
Right, it's not going to have those, it's not going to have a generator.
We don't address, I don't see that it addresses those push carts anywhere else.
It does in 1A.
Yeah, it does in 1A.
Well, beyond that, though, we don't go into a definition
of what that is. That's my point, is that if we're going to call a push cart, we're saying a mobile food vendor is a push cart, and we're saying mobile food vendors have to be self-contained with all the accessories.
The push cart can easily work out with the hot dog stand.
Yeah.
And I don't see that being a big problem.
And we've had that, in fact.
So what I would say is pull the push cart out of 1A, fine. The push cart is a handheld cart from which a person can sell food. However you define that.
Sonny, if we put it on for the first reading, could you bring it back?
Sure.
Second reading with a better division. Definition.
I'm not trying to be cheeky. When we push these things through, then we don't think through the wording. Then it comes back and sticks you at the end, and you kind of just.
Like I said, I appreciate your input, and we can make those changes and bring it back.
If we put it on for the first reading, and somebody come up this month, you can say, well, you know, it's in a reading right now, process right now. This is the ordinance they're looking at. And the guy that maybe wanted to skirt the rules might realize that in 2 months.
We can come put the emergency clause on next month.
Well, I
got two questions. One, can we issue a moratorium on these mobile vendors now? And two, since this guy's out there building it and we're creating ordinance to stop it, Mr. Attorney, are we?
You know, and I don't know that we're trying to stop it. I think we're trying to make
regulate.
It reasonable.
And really, as I read the ordinance, those are the only things that I have issue with is striking the mobile vendors, so we don't have this conflict of what's a mobile vendor, what's an outside vendor. Take that out, and then, you know, fix that 1A where we're gonna make it difficult.
Well, if we've got the other ordinance that y'all say
we got. And I'm good with this stuff, I'm good with.
Just if we've got the other ordinance that y'all say we have that's addressing mobile vendors, then why can't, I mean, is that defining just mobile vendors, like you're saying, in this deal, or can we use it to cover the mobile food vendor?
It doesn't talk about food in that other ordinance. It does exempt, actually, some services from it. Groceries, spices, tea, coffee. Not really. It doesn't address prepared food like this.
Hey, Sonny.
Yeah.
We're talking 1A about, as set forth by the Arkansas Department of Health, do they establish Department of Health established these kinds of rules?
Yeah, for mobile food truck.
For mobile food truck. And so are their rules going to be better than what we're going to come up with here?
No,
in other words, are they going to require water tanks and
yes,
so
they do.
Forth?
That's why, you know, we're that part of it we're mirroring there, but also their part will not allow wastewater going off into a holding tank and things like that.
Well, I like what Sonny's done with the ordinance. I mean, he kind of put the burden on the food vendor to come in with showing that they have the certification from the health department before he issued their permit. So I think the best thing is just clean up the language that you have there and then put the emergency clause and pass it next month. I don't really think you need a moratorium, which will be passed the next month, but it's going to affect everybody anyway. So.
One of the things that the health department requires is a grease trap inside the truck itself. So, you know, they, like I said, they've got things that they require that are over and above what.
I mean, before they, what I'm asking is, this guy doesn't sound like he's in compliance with this Arkansas Department of Health.
He is, minus two things, the wastewater holding tank and hooking up to the sewer. And he does have the water holding tank on there, you know, for fresh water, but he doesn't have the wastewater. And we talked to him today, and an LP guy that says, you know, he could put a smaller tank and mount it on the truck, so it would be, that part of it would be self-contained. So we're whittling away at it.
Sonny, on section 3E, is he in compliance with that? With the restrooms? What does state law require?
It says, let's see, where are you?
It depends on your seating.
Again, that's a state of Arkansas requirement. I mean, we're not allowing it, you know, unless it's at a festival or something like that. The same way with their tables and chairs, shall not provide or allow any dining area, including but not limited to tables, chairs, booths, bar stools, benches, and stand-up counters, unless a proposal for such seating arrangement is submitted with the permit application approved by the mayor or his designated representative.
Then your snow phone stands would be in violation, you know.
Well, no, but the mayor, I mean, it can be allowed.
Yes.
The seating can be allowed. It's just saying it's not allowed unless you apply with your permit.
Not really.
I'm not sure what
lamps, you know, that's.
That to me is the bigger deal. I mean, that's where. How long they can stay there. I mean, it seems to me like Arkansas Department of Health regulations exist that dictate what a mobile food truck can do. And he's not in compliance.
So he's slowly coming in compliance.
So he can't get a privilege license from us. We can go out there and say, you're not compliant. You got to get out of here with that truck.
Right now, it's like having a big van parked next to your house.
It's pretty trashy, but I ain't gonna lie.
Yeah, it's a UPS truck.
I'm not gonna sugarcoat it.
Yeah, well, so that's what I'd like to see is that a mobile food truck needs to be mobile, not permanently parked out there in front of a house.
So it'd be mobile. It just depending on how long they wanted to keep it at that point, but they'd have to be able to move it, you know, at a short period of time, like it says there. You know, we have the smaller people that come down on the square. You know, they're not a mobile food truck. They are a food vendor.
Is the guy currently doing business?
No.
That snow cone shack's mobile if you hook up to it with a truck.
Is there any way to put any language in it?
I didn't know that.
People can stay in there for 6 months at a whack? Because I mean,
I haven't seen any ordinances by Fort Smith, Fayetteville, or anything else that gives them a time limit on them.
In fact, they encourage. I mean, you go to Fayetteville, and there's two different. I mean, now
they got places for them.
Yes. Right, but the place, and I'm not disagreeing. This place where he's talking about, if he moved that trailer out in that parking lot more, if he just disconnected from the sewer and the water. He is a mobile. I mean, he's pretty darn close to being what we're requiring him to be, even though we don't particularly like the color. I mean, the way it looks, it's kind of it's not your more attractive one. But we don't have an ordinance to say that it's got to be freshly painted or anything. Yeah.
But like the Blazing Burrito, mobile food, somebody might not like the way that it's painted, that, you know, it's...
But a lot of these food vendors, already saying, a lot of these food vendors at where they are supposed to be in a designated area, I mean, they're there almost permanently. Depending on how good a business.
So is there any kind of language you put in there limiting where they're at in town?
Well, he's got it under, yeah. Got it under certain...
Got to be under commercial.
Commercial, got it.
You know, commercial areas, got to be on private property.
Oh, you already had that verbiage too, in order to clear everybody off the square.
Well, I guess, how's that pertaining to the popsicle guy that comes around? I mean, you know, are there even such things anymore?
So I'm looking at the Arkansas Health Department website, and in order to, it defines what a mobile food vendor is, it defines what a push cart is. And it says a push cart is indeed, must permanently have amounted fresh water and waste holding tanks, but it's non-self-propelled. And it also further defines what a mobile food vendor is. It says, here's a frequently asked question from their website. What is required to permit a mobile food unit? Well, you must submit a retail food plan review guideline. You think that guy submitted a retail food plan
guideline? He has to show it to us if he has.
So some of this definitions, we can just refer, I mean, if we say in Section A, all mobile food vendors shall comply with all applicable rules and regulations pertaining to food establishments set forth by the regulatory blah, blah, that's a pretty...
The same way that we do the fire code, we adopted by reference.
They've got a pretty detailed list of stuff. This retail food plan review guide, it's got its own little separate link I hit to, and it's got a whole bunch of, you've got to submit it for review with our environmental health specialist located in your county health unit. So there's some regulations there that we can ask these guys if they're doing and have, and if they're not, then we can turn them into the health department, correct?
Well, in Section 2, A, says the mobile food vendors shall comply with all applicable rules.
That's what I'm saying. I mean, if in their definitions, we just reference the state health department definitions, we can just say, we choose to define mobile food vendor push cart, as defined by the...
And under that, under Section B, it says they must, when they apply for a business license after obtaining all required permits issued by the state.
So we ought to be able to go down there and ask this fella, do you have your permit from the state health department?
But they haven't asked for a business license.
We ought to be able to go down there and ask him.
What's the name of it?
Pardon?
Sushi, or, what's in that box?
We have one somebody, we issued one somebody. Yeah, because we don't ask those things.
Well, like that, we didn't have this in position so that Charlotte say, you know, here's our ordinance, you've got to...
We did that on all of our previous licenses. Somebody calls up and says, I want a previous license for a plumbing company, we don't ask for their... She didn't ask for their license. She's never asked me for my license.
Well, with this this ordinance in place, you can ask for that.
It's a good ordinance. I think we just need to clean up the language a little bit on the definitions. And you know, if the health department chooses to define both mobile food vendor and push cart, we should separate them out and define them separately. And I think we ought to take mobile vendor out anywhere it says mobile vendor. And otherwise, I think the rest of this is a good ordinance.
Well, one of my visions is the ice cream trucks. I mean, you know, they go through
residential. You're talking about the drive
around? Yeah. I mean, was that technically considered a mobile food vendor?
I think it is, if I'm reading this right.
And so he's going through residential neighborhoods. I mean, that's where the kids are.
I don't know, Charlotte, what do you...
In there, it says if you're going to be moving around place, you're going to have to do solicitor's license in addition to the privilege license. You've got to take both of those. Overall, just to do business, it's $25.
But you can't be just restricted to C1, C2, C3. I mean, he's going through neighborhoods. Does this say specifically, sorry, that we are going to require that of them, we the city, before we sell? Does it say before we sell the license? I mean, it's the...
They have to provide that from the...
Can you tell me where that is?
Talking about privilege?
Section 2, A and B.
Shall comply with all applicable rules and regulations pertaining to food establishments set forth by the authority, and the other compliance advice shall not connect to city services.
section B really wants that mobile vendors can apply for business license after first obtaining all required permits issued by the state.
The only problem with that is that the way our approval licenses are issued, someone goes to the bar office and they take the money and they just fill out a name and address, contact information form, they hand us $25 and they get the approval license. That's it. Because that's all we want for it to do. That changes that. I don't know how those bar office ladies are going to know whether these people are in mobile vendors without just asking them. So we can't enforce that very easily.
They probably shouldn't be the ones handing out the approval licenses.
Well, aren't they applying for?
I really love to not do that.
But it's, I know, but it's a deal where, I mean.
But when they ask for those privilege licenses, they have not have to tell you what's for.
They're going to get.
I mean, when they buy, when they come in to get a privilege license, do they not have to tell you what it's for? In order to get it?
No, but I mean.
So they could just come in and say, one privilege license, and we sell them one, it doesn't matter.
If we don't ask what it's for.
They have a, there's a form that says your business address, contact information.
I don't have the type of business.
Well, in the name of it, but no.
Do you have the contract for that?
It doesn't sound like we're enforcing our mobile vendor ordinance up.
We don't have one.
Well, we have that.
That's a solicitor.
Whatever that thing is, we're just talking.
Yeah, even that.
Business privilege.
Two different things.
Sonny?
Yes.
Sonny?
Yes.
Is there, are there not, you know, we're trying to make it fit C1, C2, C3, and I1, but even in that, there's places we may not want them to be. Are there not any communities that add a zoning just?
They do when they have a designated place for one, like Fort Smith, you know, they have one place downtown, but they also allow them at other places too. Now, if we had a designated place, you know, say, pick out a place. This is our mobile food.
108 Main Street.
That's what I was going to say.
You know, something like that. And say, this is our mobile food vending here. Then, and the other place.
Could we not just zone like four or five places and say, this is the mobile, this is where you can be. You can pick any of those four or five places.
Well, where you got to live?
What's your address, Lance?
We can probably do that, but you're going to have to find the property.
Well, I think, well, that's why you have a plan, maybe just.
Well, for example, across from Mazio, you know, you got a big empty parking lot.
Right.
That'd be a great place. I'm not going to put a mobile food truck up there and do it.
And those are things planning commission rests.
One, we got to have permission from the person that owns the property.
Right.
And that's what they've gone. They were looking originally at over here by Siemens. Car wash and ran into some problems with the person that owned that, and so they looked at this property across from McDonald's, and this guy, you know, made him a deal, and so that's where they chose to put it, which is not a bad place for food trucks.
But I think a lot of that will probably be eliminated if, going back to section 2B, where they have to, you know, really first comply with all required permits issued by the state of Arkansas. I mean, because if that means that they're not just going to be, oh, I've got my little pickup truck and I'm going to sell, you know,
if we don't sell a permit, this is called a permit.
Privilege.
If we don't sell them a privilege license until they meet those requirements, then it's an easy, I mean, I'm not saying it's an easy task for somebody to take that, but I mean, that fixes it. You can't get a city privilege license until you meet these requirements.
I think though, apparently when you look at a privilege license though, and
you walk in, you get $25 to get a privilege license.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
What your business is.
I guarantee you we have people running around with privilege license and unlicensed contract.
Well, there's.
Public license contract around with privilege license.
Here we had a while ago, under section 3, B, says operation of the hour between 6 a.m. and 11 p.m. and will not leave the unit unattended.
Okay. So how do you address that if it's midnight and we got a food truck parked over there and it's, nobody's around it?
Well. Tell me, code enforcement police would tell us that food truck was still there after 11 p.m. and we would knock on the door and say, you can't do that anymore. If they do, then we'd have to follow through with.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Where's our teeth in that as far as
They will chime.
The rentals be in the house.
We don't have no, I mean, to me, there's no teeth to, I mean, because I said, well, heck, I didn't know, and then, I mean, we're just gonna tell them to quit doing it, I mean.
What, we can institute, put fine penalty on the back end?
Yeah, like I said, I don't ever see the instance where somebody says, well, you don't have a fine on it, I'm not gonna do it, we'll walk up there and knock on the door.
Where is that one?
It's in 3C or 3B or something.
Second, I was talking about somebody being there for a length of time, and it says in that section 3B that they will not leave the unit unattended.
Oh.
But what, we don't have no teeth as far as making that, if they do leave it, you know what I'm saying, I mean, that's kind of our.
I don't think that's a, and Sonny brought this to me and asked me, and I looked at it, that one would be difficult, I mean, if you're gonna, if the city designated an area for sure, nobody expects people to stay at that.
They're both.
I know, but they don't leave like in Fayetteville, I just keep going back to these areas that have these, they don't haul those off.
We don't have that.
To me, that goes back to what Mark was saying, we need the zones of areas that are gonna be, people are gonna camp out for months, and they're gonna be there from 6 to 11.
We're not.
If you're gonna be in this deal over here, and if you're gonna be in this deal, I mean, there's gonna be.
In a zone, in a particular area.
Right, like what I'm saying, zoning, different areas, well, this, zone one, you could be there.
Here are the restrictions that go with.
Here's restrictions for zone one, zone two, zone three, zone four.
For instance, not to, the barbecue place out here, who's in the barbecue boat, they don't, I mean, that doesn't leave. And we're not, of course, I know we don't have anything in place yet.
Yeah, kind of grandfathered in, but, you know, C1, that opens it up, so when we have festivals, we can be down around the square.
Right.
C2 is a commercial along Center Street, C3.
Is that House by Taco Bell commercial?
Pardon?
The House by Taco Bell, that's a commercial?
It is.
Yes, yes.
The one they're at?
The people there all the time, that.
The house between we.
Oh.
Between Sonny and Taco Bell.
Oh.
It seems to be occupied.
Yeah, someone lives there, you know, you're right.
Why do we let them live in it if it's some commercial?
Because our, the way that it, the zoning states, if one time that was all residential, it's been rezoned to C2, okay, as long as the people live there, continues to be a resident, they can continue to live there. Once it becomes a business, which, it became a business.
Mostly empty.
Then it will never go back to residential unless they come in and ask for variance, that would have to be approved by the council, that they, you know, like a base use.
That house was a big mac shop or something, one of them.
Or a lot.
Or a lot.
But they've always had somebody living in the back of it, working the business, you know, as far as I know.
It's not a business now.
I don't know what it is.
Yeah, people live in it. We got a guy wanting to live in a storage building for 24-hour guard, that's what I told you, if you told me I couldn't live in that house with that purple truck, it's a problem with 24-hour guard. I'm glad they didn't meet first. Yeah, obviously, it didn't meet 24-hour guard, man. I know a guy who built a little storage out here on the east side of town, the 24-hour guard lived on commercial property. Got metal. That's just my two cents worth. We're talking about gonna put big little 5 foot of grass over here to do our own, for the city to abide by stuff, or whatever, everybody can buy city rules in here.
So Sonny, we can put this on for first reading, and then we know it's all wrong, all the questions.
We'll work on the changes that you guys have made, and present it back to you next month.
Somebody show up with a food truck, you tell them, better get all their stuff.
I make a motion with this on the first reading. May first, I'm sorry.
Second.
Thank you.
We have a motion and second.
I can watch recap changes that were made.
All right.
Long process from.
All right.
So what are the main things that are changing?
We wanna clear the definitions.
Take mobile vendor out.
Right, mobile vendors out.
Clarify definitions, remove mobile vendor.
Section 1A, where it's, like I said, we do, it said that the waterways, the state of Arkansas, it shall be.
Well, I think we just go to the Arkansas State health department's website and pull their definition straight in. I mean, they've got a definition, they don't...
I would suggest we reference it in case they change theirs.
Sure, just say...
Rather than rewrite it.
We, you know...
We adopt theirs by...
We define mobile food vendor as defined by the state health department.
Yes.
We define push cart as defined by the state health department, reference their website.
Do you want a penalty section added in this ordinance?
Yes. Yes.
That's the main thing, right? Mr. Brown?
Yes.
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 Yes. An ordinance regulating operation of mobile food vendors / mobile vendors concession shadow trailers, push carts in the city of Greenwood, Arkansas, requiring a permit, declaring an emergency in front of them.
Thank you, Sonny.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Number three, Sonny, support.
This is a resolution to provide funding for the election. It was held in November. We received the bill this year. It's probably around the time that we passed the budget, maybe a few days before, but it did not get in the budget. Total invoice is 547.898, which comes to 685 per fund.
Motion to approve this resolution.
Second.
Motion and a second to approve the resolution.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
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 And the next resolution, when we purchased a vehicle, we remembered insurance, but we did not remember fuel.
We have one taken out.
So we'd like to transfer $1,000 from 63601 Transportation Mayor to 65600 Fuel Vehicles within the general.
I'd like to motion to pass the resolution.
Second.
Motion in 2 seconds.
All right. Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Yes.
Mr. McDaniel?
Yes.
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 Thank you.
And then the next one is an ordinance, amending ordinance 16-9, establishing the salary and regulating expected work hours and benefits for the elected city clerk treasurer for the city of Greenwood, declaring an emergency and for other purposes. We had passed an increase in salary, but we need to do it by ordinance.
Take motion to put the source on first reading by title.
Second. Motion is second.
Yes.
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 The ordinance amending ordinance number 16-09, establishing the salary and regulating expected work hours and benefits for the elected city clerk treasurer of the city of Greenwood, declaring an emergency and for other purposes.
I make a motion to waive for the second, third reading.
Second.
Motion is second, waive for the second, third reading.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
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 Yes. I make a motion we enact the emergency clause.
Second.
That's adopt.
Adopt the clause.
Motion and a second to adopt the emergency clause.
We'll make a motion to adopt.
Adopt.
Dr. Johnson.
Sorry.
This is a motion to second to adopt the ordinance.
Correct.
Right. Well, that's it.
Emergency.
I'm sorry.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
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 Daniel?
Yes.
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 Make a motion to enact emergency clause.
Second. Motion second to enact emergency clause.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
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 Daniel?
Yes.
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 Thank you.
Okay, and the last one I have, in the police fund, the office manager and then animal control code enforcement officer, when I pulled the beginning salary, I pulled the wrong figure. I pulled the figure prior to the raise that they received in 2016. Due to when I was drilling into the software, I just drilled into the wrong field. We did approve a 3%, so the correct 3% for the water office manager needs to be increased by by $1,022.73, funding available in 11-140 cash and bank police. And then for animal control code enforcement officer, it's 80340, with the funding available 70250, the funding from county sales tax.
Wait, I see the police, where you're saying, you said water office too?
No, code enforcement, the office manager within the.
Oh, office manager, okay.
You said water somewhere in there.
That was there, I didn't. And the police office manager, and then code enforcement animal control officer. Just drilled into the wrong area within the new software.
Make a motion, we accept this resolution by title only.
Second.
Motion second to accept by title only.
Or pass the resolution.
Okay.
Yes, that's what I meant, pass the resolution, I just read, echoing your.
We have.
You do what that.
Mr. Powell.
Mr. Dahl.
Yes.
Dr. Johnson.
Yes.
Powell.
Yes.
Mr. Daniel.
Yes.
Tim Terry.
Yes.
Mr.
Yes.
Thank you. And department reports and questions from council. We have most of them, or a few left here, if you want to ask any questions regarding the bills or reports.
I have a question about streets. On your capital, he's like, damn it, regard it. It's a quick question, easy question. In your budget under capital expenditures, you had your two big trucks, you had the snow plow. Have those items been purchased yet?
No, sir.
So there's I'm just thinking ahead of this building and what it might or might not come in as a bid and.
We've ordered the pickup trucks. We have snow plows and stuff in the room. We haven't paid for anything yet. This is not here.
But they're ordered.
Yep.
So
the trailer is already purchased.
The reason I'm asking is because there's $113,000 there. If you had to choose between trucks and the snow.
We have two trucks that are on the last leg.
So you got to have the trucks.
I've got to have the
trucks. What about the snow plow?
I don't have to have that, but you know, if we have that incident.
Well, I mean, I understand that, but when I look at what money you have in savings, street savings, that's $114,000. And when I look at what's projected to be in the bank at the end of 2017, that's $280,000. That's $415,000.
When we started this whole building remodel thing, you're supposed to come in at like $200,000. It's doubled in price since then. I have no idea why. Even since the last time I talked, it's doubled in price. I have no idea why.
So I'm just thinking ahead. I mean, if we don't know these bids, they may come in at $180,000, we may be fine. But if that's why I was going to say, if you say you got to have them, you got to have them. If you hadn't purchased them yet, I was going to say maybe you can hold off until we at least see what the bids are, and then you can make an educated choice over.
Well, I have notified that the plow distributor and everything to work with all of those parts, the plow and the new spray from the new pickup truck. I don't know if it's in route or what, but we can't do anything until we have the trucks in, you know, for them to install them.
It's okay, just a question. Maybe it'll come in good shape. I just thought of that as I was going to ask you.
There's a chance you can come in under 200 on the building.
Sure.
I think we could demolish the building and build it new for $200,000. I mean, I don't know. It just seems crazy. That much money.
You're obviously not big.
Not in this town. That is an interesting
comment. We'll get a bid from the boogeyman on this
new building. Well, you know, you see it advertised, I know they're not maybe the same, but what's the general, if you will, commercial?
Well, yeah,
40
by 16, 35 to 40,000. Yeah. Not necessarily.
Right.
I guess where you're going to do is the street park lot, they demolish it.
Oh, they go. They might do it.
Well, let's have faith in our bidding process and hope for the best.
Oh, everybody should.
Just take a look down there.
Any other department reports, questions? Yes, sir.
Just want to tell you guys a little bit about ISO. Appreciate, I know I've got contact with everybody one-on-one. We're so excited about it, but really good Steve Rattery and dispatch, big packs on the back, because they made large improvements. Steve got with me down here. We got a gentleman from ISO and went over each hydrant and looked why they were choosing the hydrant, and then found a better hydrant in that location, as long as it was close to the building, and were able to work that out and find better flows. They were able to increase a lot of those flows. I'll just put it this way, Steve really pushed that and got things flowing on that. So him and Tim made some huge strides on the water side of it. Dispatch improved quite a bit, and then we were able to improve quite a bit on training and several things. One thing we can improve on in the future now, which things equal out, but one thing it said was our distribution of was apparatus, which Station 3 will help us with that, and probably cover that whole area and hopefully give us some closer full credit on that part of it. But just to let you guys know, 1988, we were a 7. And then we'd get another grade until 2005 when we turned to a 5. And in 2015, we moved to a 4. And 2 years later, in 2017, we moved to a 3. And so they changed how they do this every 3 years. They're going to come in and call 2 or 3 times a year. What's really nice is if we do make a large improvement, I'd call and say, here's a large improvement, and they will change the score. Unfortunately, it will work in reverse, too. So maybe you go ahead and make a large tract of land with nothing on it, with a bunch of houses, no hydrants, you can build the other
direction. Great. When we build Station 3, we can call them and ask them to calculate that in. Okay. And we're 3/10 of a point away from being a 2.
2.5 tenths.
They're 2.5 tenths from being a 2.
Yeah.
It's all close.
Has the rural lower to 3 yet, or we wait a couple weeks for the rural fire department?
It just has to do when you get your ISO check. He actually came 2 years on this one, took 3, and so it was nice because he knew we made a lot of changes. But we were very proud to get a 3. I was looking at the numbers, and there's only in the hundreds that are 1s. There's a couple thousand that are 2s, and 3,000 that are 3s, I believe, a whole lot. So we're pretty big company. I called him the other day to come down and do this. He said, wow, I couldn't believe I got the 3. I always got the 3, you got real high. And so he said, you're in a late company. And I said, I think this sounds great to me. So there was one other thing on here. Yeah, definitely get with the get with Steve and Tim, and they made some major improvements that we didn't know if they'd be able to do or not with the stuff that was happening with the amount of water that we can get to the system. So I'm very excited. But anyway, thanks for your support and hard work on this. I know everybody's been working on it. As you can see, since 2005, we made some great strides. And I think Dustin was telling me when he was interviewing me on the paper that one of the insurance agents said it could be a cost savings per person of $50 on their insurance. I sure hope it is, but I like to see my insurance quite a bit. So, thank you.
Thank you, Chief, and thank you for your hard work on that. We know that it's a joint effort. And on that note, I received a call from Mr. Ciesla today, and we're just kind of tied in until the Chief this year, but he was just kind of touching base on the property, the school's property up there, and if we were still interested. And I said, we are interested, but we're more interested in what the real selling price is instead of the appraised value. I believe it was a 350, 390, and he said he would deal with the board. Yeah, he would deal with, as far as he knew, the board was not even fully aware, maybe that it had been appraised, but I just wanted to tell him that we, I hope I didn't hear about saying we're not necessarily interested in that 390 price, but we'd like to know what your real selling price is.
So it was 9 acres, wasn't it?
It's not 7 or 9 acres.
It's 9 acres.
About 3 acres.
2.5 of this building, rest of it is either in the floodplain or in the floodway.
So we have to buy the rest of it?
We have to. We have certain areas, it has to do with where the roads will go through and all that stuff.
Is that where we want fire station three?
I think that's number one.
I think that's our number one choice, I think, let's talk to them and see what we can get, give them the.
We want the 2.5 acres out of the floodplain is what we're at.
Absolutely, and if we can get the rest of it, we'll be parking a lot or whatever we'll do with it in the future. And I think that's for that, could be a place for the park area, for the trailers, trailhead or something like that.
That would be a good place to make a relief from Liberty Drive over to, on the Palmer Street, make the Damon Saddle Drive, whatever it is. You could tie those two together easily, but at a small cost.
We've got some cost estimates in, and we want to talk to them about when we negotiate on this and see what we can. I was hoping you'd set a meeting today, but I talked to you.
How much are we?
No.
The school resource officer, how much, they're splitting the salary with us, is that what they're doing?
With the resource officer, probably.
And how much is the resource officer, how much are we paying, how much is their portion and our portion?
I think about $60,000.
$60,000?
I believe it's $67,000.
So I'm just trying to outside the box think here, I mean, if there's ways to barter with the school without writing a big fat check, you know, one thought option, and I know that hurts the bottom line for the police department, and I don't know that that's what we want to do, but a thought could be, hey, for 10 years, or for 5 years, or whatever, we'll give you the resource officer. We'll take over the salary for the resource officer for the next 5 years in exchange for this property. And that would give us a way to prorate this instead of just giving out a check for $250,000 or whatever you had. Gives the school some value, we get the land. There's some other ways to think about that, I don't know, the Gary Street, what used to be Gary Street, that's theirs now, is that right? Did we give that to them, or did they purchase that from us?
We gave it to them.
So I mean, these are some things I think to think about, we were discussing things with the school, some ideas of ways to maybe remind them that we're doing good services for them as well.
I think $2,000 more than what we'll enjoy it.
I know you're saying, so we'd love to pay for that land.
I can see it as a dirt by your line. At the Trump.
So Mayor, why are you leaving it with them, why are we not going to them and saying this is what I'm going to do?
Well, because I don't know what you're willing to do.
Well, we had, he just talked with him.
It was just him asking if we were interested, I said, yes, we are, but not for the appraised price. I asked him to give me a price.
Well, if you remember, we were going to have an auction fee to file that, because we've been getting some cost estimates.
I mean, if you tell me something. If you tell me something to offer, I'll offer it.
Don't give me any price right now. I'd rather go over and strong arm some folks before we start playing with dollars. I'm not talking about you.
I'm just saying.
Well, I mean, let me just ask, is it reasonable to say to the school, will you just give it to us for free?
It is reasonable and they will not.
Yeah, so now we know they're not going to give it to us, what do we have that they might want besides cash?
Well, they can't give it to you.
Right, they can't.
Not take it for free.
And when we had our meeting before Christmas, they had talked about maybe finding some ways to, whether it's repairs on streets.
Well, this connector that he's talking about, what if we agreed to build the connector?
They don't want that.
They shut down the road to begin with.
Well, if they don't own the property, it don't matter if they own it.
Well, he's using it all for negotiation.
That's not a bargain.
I'm just asking, I'm just trying to think of, because I don't know that we have $200,000.
I mean, I like your idea of somehow making payments on it, whether it's through, you know, making arrangements for this officer. I mean, I think that's a good way to look at it. Not only have they said they couldn't sell it, they couldn't give it to us, I didn't get that answer today, but originally when I asked the question,
I got the answer, they didn't know if they could even sell it for less than the appraised value because of the Navy school.
I think Dr. Lee has a good point, is in saying, in consideration of us giving, you know, Gary Street to them, you know, that's helping with the negotiated price.
In perspective on this, the school gave $153,000 for 53 acres. They're wanting to sell us what's in the floodplain for $390,000.
Well, we don't know they want to sell us for $390,000. That's just what the
price. That's just what that's
what they. And that doesn't constrain.
And the appraisal came in with huge exceptions, which it said it all over the red flag, it all over because of the floodplain.
Well, they compared it to the council. One of the councilmen on 10 Spur, we're building a new Dollar Tree, which is perfect. That's an interesting comparison.
Well, right now,
but that's not our school, that's only appraisal.
You just need to get with them and come back and you know where we're at on this.
We'll visit with them.
But if asked, that's our number one spot still. We want that piece of property.
I think. When it comes to road miles, we looked at it at the fire department. Western Arkansas Planning do a road mile comparison, and it basically is the best place for us, as long as our city limit stays where it's
at. We can get in and out of it, we're going to be able to get access to it.
Appreciate it.
You know, I'm talking about the crossing highway. Trying to leave the open this week.
I was just going to another comment, but
this is
I had the good fortune of going to an Eagle Scout ceremony this Saturday, and it involved really three of our city personnel here. It's Rod Powell's son, and Rod was kind of the conductor of master ceremonies. Our mayor gave a very good speech within the time allotted, so minutes. And Anne was given a mentor pin. Again, I was very impressed with the overall ceremony, and it was that it's just the volunteerism of our city folks. I'm really, really proud of our city.
It was a really neat event. Very cool. On that note, that's a happy note, but I do want to ask for prayers tonight for a family. Walmart, thank you. This is a family that two boys, and these are girls, three kids, two still in high school.
Three boys.
They're all in school, I guess.
Two older ones are just
okay. They lost their mom 2 years ago? 5 years ago. Well, they went 5 years ago, and then now their dad has passed away, so these kids are, I know the school, they're going to be using the facility up in Bill Park after the funeral Wednesday. Coach Jones came by today to talk to me about that, and they're expecting 150-200 people to come up there because the whole football team's and parents and his coaches and everything, so if we remember that family and your prayers. Any other thoughts before we adjourn?
I just had that one.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No big deal or anything like that. I just want to let you know that if you were to look at this budget resolution adopting a 2017 budget, compare it to the first resolution where we adopted the budget in 2016, the number is not the same because we have to go back later on in the year and change it because there was a mistake that I carried forward 2 years in a row. So it says the correct thing finally. I did not make the same mistake 3 times in a row. It says $5,000 spending limit for any single item here. Not in the budget. So I'm sorry if that's confusing sounding. I just want to let y'all know because when I took the vote last time, when we passed the budget, I said you want to use the same verbiage and technically this, the $5,000 versus the old $2,500 number. That's the difference. So it's correct. It's correct, and like it should be, but it's different than the 2016 one.
Sorry. That.
Is this still council forum?
Yes.
Are we going to have some sort of look into a way of doing things with the business privilege license?
Yes.
Such as having water ladies?
Yes. I'll visit with the department.
And that's legitimate.
Well, let me ask you.
Well, why would they take the money? That's
nothing against them. I'm just saying there needs to be
You know, I didn't see your state license, I'm gonna see your blood.
Especially for restaurateurs and people selling food, hey, where's your...
Or plumbers, or...
Well, we'll get Charlotte and I will be involved, we'll get with Tim, he's in charge of those ladies up there, you'll see what we...
On that, Sonny or whoever.
Yeah.
On that A&P deal?
Yes, sir.
I pulled up the code of ordinances for the, you know, what? They're saying in here, shall be duty of the seller, blah, 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 on the 20th day of each calendar month to deliver to the commission or its designated agent forms prescribed and furnished by the commission. A tax return under oath showing the total combined gross receipts, which are subject to A&P tax for the preceding calendar month and the amount of tax due. So they're putting the onus on them to bring me your tax receipt for the prior month. That's where they're establishing the number. Is that what ours says?
It's real similar. I don't have forms and we didn't have that form and it was out there.
That's A&P.
I acknowledge that this is the true and correct, blah, blah, but not everybody...
You're saying all go, we go on the honor system.
Yeah.
Well, as far as...
What we're saying is there's not accountability. We're not saying that we could,
our guidance administration does for audits on local businesses,
we could kind of form the backside of that every time they do it.
Of course, there's a, there is a, as you know, probably in the business, there's a delay. You're not, I mean, I don't even know if you're, are you collecting monies for last month? I mean, just that quick? So if you're having to go through the finance, you know, those folks state, it would probably be pretty much delayed.
What's delayed?
One month, yeah.
They don't all turn in a form, and when they don't, well, we just take their money and they come in the form.
If you pay it on the 20th, you get a discount. And so, but then after a month, they come in and they lock you up and shut you down. So you get about 10 days to...
It's just hard for, it's up to the city clerk, as it was, we said, you know, I send y'all emails and I keep up with it as best I can. They can do a fair job of it, just for one person.
Yeah.
And, but when it comes down to these pesky ones that are not doing what they're supposed to do, all our recourse I've got is to hand it over to Mike and say, they're not doing what's supposed to be. And y'all first, you know, it's y'all.
But to answer your, we'll look into it better.
That's what the privilege license, but on our A&P tax, there, we have a form, but they're supposed to be sending in, and they're supposed to sign it that says, I testify that this is the true receipts.
I don't like that. The car got a big dome, eating chips and dips, keeping tab over sales.
Hey, wait, one second. Tim Terry's comment earlier about the rent house between KFC and the Sonic.
Mm-hmm.
If that's zoned as commercial, people are living in that house.
Well, I asked Sonny about that. He said it was, you know, they've been consistently living in it, so they have a variance. Once they move out, and it turns into a business.
At some point, nobody was living there. It was a furniture store or some kind of deal.
It was a residence, a car lot, an antique store, now it's residence.
It's been kind of like what Tim said. There's always been somebody there saying, you know, I'm the security guard, or, you know, there's somebody been living there. You know, once it's empty, and then it cannot be lived in again.
We don't have any
unless, they are, again, a security guard.
It's not the same renters, though, is my whole
point. I agree. No, it's not, because one of the gentlemen who was there was the one that was charged and, you know, killing another dog.
Yeah, right.
On a good note, we were very highly complimented on the group of developers that were here just recently this week that are building those three, AT&T, the Dollar Tree, and the Anytime Fitness. They came and met with Sonny and myself and all the department heads to look over the plans, and they were very impressed with being able to sit down with a big group at one time and do business that way. And now, granted, they had all their ducks in a row, so it was a pretty good way for us to handle it too, but they were very complimentary, and they said they would, you know, we have had in the past a reputation of not being easy to deal with in Greenwood when it comes to building, but these folks are very impressed. So I want to pass that on to the council, with the department heads are working very well together and getting things accomplished.
Is
Any others, anything else, this person?
Right, I just want to comment, is there a reason the AEP commission doesn't have a report for you every month? They're a commission.
We don't get, in fairness, we don't get a report, we don't, AEP doesn't meet monthly, and we don't get a report, we can talk about it with the planning commission, we're not getting reports specifically.
Help answer some of your concerns here, maybe if you did your.
I mean, I report, give y'all every time we meet.
For the AEP?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I know, but Gary, he's asking, should AEP give a report to the council?
The chairman of that commission.
There's no reason why they could.
I think we should call in Mr. McAllister.
We're meeting once a quarter, so we could make, come in every 6 months.
You got a lot of questions.
We got two commissioners up here.
I'm trying to answer them. What do y'all want?
What would you like to make?
You're at the mercy of restaurants and/or hotels coming in here, just turning in the receipts of what the percentage of what their income is, I don't know, what can we get from you? I mean, I don't know.
Well, we could give you.
What the money is spent on.
What the money's being spent on.
That's normally, we know that.
We get the revenue report every time on this thing.
We can give you a report of who's behind it.
Every month I get the revenue report on this report.
Y'all might like, it is interesting, one of the most interesting things I like to look at is that report of revenue that shows, you know, the whole list of restaurants and who's paying what, and kind of gives you an idea. It's kind of an interesting thing, it gives you the idea of which restaurants were probably the busiest.
Really interesting to see how much Baskin Robbins added.
Baskin Robbins, you would have thought there was.
You put your vote.
That was a good deal. I mean, everybody that eats pizza buys a milkshake, that's for sure.
Like Greenwood Nursing ice cream.
That's what I'm saying, I want some on this side, I'm tired of coming in here with all the rich people.
I think somebody's working.
Well, those records are in my office, I mean, time you want to see them.
Yes, I did, sorry. Remind me, Ms. Tammy, I need to print out the information that Mr. Terry sent to us, and it's called. We need to get that printed.
We'll do it next meeting.
It's at all council, I mean.
Oh, okay.
Sorry, I apologize.
Charlotte, all this stuff, there's not anything except the new, I have all this in email form, I think, correct?
Yeah, packet.
I don't think there's anything except the one new, did we even want that in the agenda, was it?
We didn't officially add anything to it.
That was passed out here.
So if I leave this here, I'm not leaving anything that I don't have right here, correct? Because I take, it seems like every month I pick this out, and I get it home, and I think, well, I've got all this on my phone, I'm going to do this. I'm not having it here, but I just.
One of them, you say budget.
He's in here and just walks away, it's not here, it's not here.
You don't have your budget on your phone, probably.
No, I do, I have a budget on my phone, this red line that Ann has sent me, just the only thing.
Well, that's the new.
New amended version, this, you can send me a.
I can send you a new amended.
So that I can have it on my phone, so that I don't have to. I might take my hard copy of the budget, just in case.
She works here, she knows, it's a cool folder.
I like you, I don't know.
I would entertain a motion to.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And first there.
This is, but then, straight to the line.